This year, Google joined Apple in offering a small pro-branded flagship smartphone. So Apple already had some direct competition when it hit the market with the iPhone 16 Pro. But how do these two compact powerhouses compare? I'm Cam Bunton, this is Trusted Reviews, and in this video, I'm going to answer that question. Now, in certain corners of the internet, the Google Pixel 9 Pro series was called the iPhone of the Android world. And when you look at the design, the shaping, the materials, you can certainly see why that term was coined. In terms of size and shaping, it looks and feels almost identical to the iPhone 16 Pro. It weighs exactly the same, has the same flat metal frame around the outside with rounded corners, and slightly rounded angles at the front and the back to ensure that join between the glass and the frame isn't completely right angled and sharp. Even when you look at the thickness and the width, it's almost the same. Pixel is taller, and that's about it. But what it means is that when it comes to using and holding the phone one-handed or even two-handed, neither has much of an advantage over the other. But of course, there are some subtle differences in other ways. Like the different texture in the hand when you hold the shiny polished aluminium on the Pixel versus the more matte smooth finish on the iPhone's titanium. Of course, aesthetically, they're quite different when you look head-on at the front or the back. iPhone has that traditional triangle of cameras in the top corner where Pixel's unique brand design features cameras in a chunky bar across the back. This also adds the benefit of ensuring it won't wobble when you set it down flat on its back. Both are also water and dust resistant to IP68 levels, meaning they can be submerged and come out unscathed. However, Apple has tested and certified its water resistant down to 6 meters, where Pixel has the more traditional 1.5 meters. In reality though, it means they'll both be fine if you accidentally drop them in the sink or in the bath. Now, given the extra depth tested and the fact that it's built from titanium and has that ceramic shield glass on the front, the iPhone is arguably the more durable. But without doing some extreme stress tests, which I'm not gonna do with these units, I can't verify that. But there are a couple of features that make a difference to iPhone both visually and functionally. One of those, of course, is the pill-shaped cutout in the display. This hosts the facial recognition hardware. Unlike Pixel's purely camera-based system, which only recognizes visual details, it can measure depth and contours in your face, adding more security and authenticity to the facial authentication process. There's also that camera control on the side, which can be used for zooming in and out within the camera app, or can be used to adjust depth, exposure, or switch between photographic styles. Now, I won't lie, it's not something I found myself instinctively reaching for when using the camera. I still default to swiping and touching on the screen, but you might just find it useful. But enough of that, let's talk displays and features because there are pluses and minuses to both of these phones here. When it comes to the screens themselves, again, there's very little difference in basic specs. Both are 6.3 inch LTPO OLED panels, both feature almost identical surface areas, but the iPhone has an ever so slightly wider aspect ratio. They can both even hit 2000 nits brightness across the entire panel when it's bright daylight conditions, and they can hit up to 120Hz refresh rates with the ability to ramp up and down quickly in small increments. Perhaps the thing that surprised me most though was how similarly they're tuned in terms of color contrast and image quality. Usually in this instance, you'd find that one is warmer or cooler, or features a different color tint, but both tend to be on the warm side of the scale when left in their default out-of-the-box settings. iPhone tends to be more on that golden yellowish side of the warm spectrum where the Pixel is slightly redder. So watching my own videos on the Pixel, my skin tone looks more like it does in real life on the iPhone than it does on the Pixel, which tends to make it look a bit rosier and pinker. iPhone did seem brighter watching everyday videos than the Pixel 2, and in real life I found myself reaching for the Pixel brightness slider a lot more frequently, because I found it too dim by default a lot of the time. But they are both strong displays, and even when looking at bright white screens from different angles, there's no extreme color shifting or drop in visibility from either phone. They're really good displays whichever phone that you pick. The real differences though come in terms of features in the software. And yes, it's iPhone versus Android, which comes with the usual differences and benefits to both phones, but there's more to it than that. The stuff that really strikes me as different and beneficial on the Pixel comes in the camera and the photography department, where you can do things like add your yourself to features using the Add Me feature. There's also a host more stuff that you can do with image generation AI that the iPhone doesn't have yet, but will be getting in an update later in the year. And with Gemini Live built already into the Pixel 9 Pro, you can chat to Google's assistant in a way that feels really natural, getting ideas for projects, researching topics, and pretty much anything else in a really natural conversational way. It's definitely ahead of Apple in that way, and although Apple Intelligence is on its way at the end of the year, we don't know exactly what that experience will be like until it lands. Now, if you were to run benchmarking and stress tests on the Pixel and the iPhone side by side, what you'll find is that the A18 processor inside the iPhone is much more powerful than the Tensor G4 inside the Pixel. Like, it's not even close. To the point where the Pixel's multi-core score was closer to the iPhone's single-core score than its own single-core score was. And the difference in capability is pretty staggering. It's similar with 3D Mark's graphics test, where it scored about half of what the iPhone can do in terms of score and frame rate performance. What that means in daily usage is that if you play the highly graphically intense games titles, the iPhone will handle them more comfortably than the Pixel will. And if you're familiar with smartphone processors, that's not something that's going to surprise you very much at all. The Pixel Tensor chipsets have never really been made for all-out performance. But here's the thing, when it comes to just using the phone day in and day out, launching casual games, apps, watching video, there's not a huge amount of benefit to having all that extra power. Games run fast and smooth on the Pixel, and they load quickly. It's a similar feeling with battery life. iPhone seems better at managing its power when it comes to using the phone for light gaming and video watching, especially with gaming. For instance, I could lose over 10% battery using the Pixel for half an hour playing Mario Kart, but the iPhone was closer to 6 or 7%. And the end result at the end of the day is that the iPhone feels more capable of lasting a full, busy workday than the Pixel 9 Pro can. Heavy users might just be able to get to the end of the day on a full charge with both, but with a Pixel, you'll be pushing it a bit, and you might find you need to carry a battery pack with you. With my more typical light usage of around 2 or 3 hours a day, of course, neither struggles to make it to the end of the day. But the iPhone would consistently have close to 50% left over after a full day, where the Pixel was closer to 35 or 40%. Okay, to the all-important camera and video now. And what surprised me perhaps more than I thought it would is that, speaking broad strokes, I found it really hard to separate these two phones. Both have a main ultra-wide and 5x zoom camera on the back, giving you similar levels of versatility. But there are differences in the experience of using those cameras and the results that you get from them. Using the iPhone with its default clean photographic style, I found the colors both indoors and outdoors were more similar to what I saw with my own eyes. However, those results can sometimes end up looking a tiny bit sterile, where white or light elements in the photo are a little bit too monochromatic and clean. You can, of course, change to a warmer tone using those photographic styles if you want to. Google Pixel tends to add a warmer, richer golden tone to every picture by default. And if you were to ask me which outdoor photos I liked the look of the most, it was the Pixels. I also found the iPhone's ultra-wide camera does deliver a little bit of a harsh-looking photo at times, struggling a little more when it comes with contrasting light conditions with bright highlights and shadows. But even here, the Pixel ultra-wide is similar. iPhone's macro ability seems stronger than the Pixel's, though seemingly able to focus cleanly at closer distances to small objects than the Google phone can. But in the end, in the daytime, indoors or out, there's not really enough to separate these two to say one is clearly better than the other. At the 5x zoom level, they process details a little bit differently, with Pixel going for that contrasty, over-sharpened look slightly, but they're both strong systems. At nighttime, however, there is a bit of a frustration, and it's got nothing to do with the actual processing of those photos. It's about how Apple's phone only engages night mode when it feels it's dark enough. You can't just go to that mode manually or switch it on, where the Pixel does have a dedicated night sight mode. So oftentimes, iPhone would just shoot a normal photo, and it'd be quite a lot darker than the Pixel, because it wasn't using the night mode algorithm. Once engaged, though, it's capable of drawing in a lot of light, delivering sharp images. I would say, though, for the most part, Pixel photos tended to look a little sharper and draw in a bit more light than the iPhone did. And this at times meant images at night were a bit too bright and made it feel less like nighttime and more like day. iPhones sometimes struggle to focus as well, especially when zooming with the primary lens to 2x zoom, when light levels were really low. All told, because of that, if I was going out taking photos at nighttime, I'd rather take the Pixel. It was just easier. There's no real contest when it comes to video capture, though. It's the one thing iPhone has always done really, really well. Not just because of all the professional codecs like ProRes and Log, but simply because video looks more consistently good. Colors and details are great, and it's stronger at evening out handshake or movement. Pixel results were quite dark and harsh, and it also struggled to focus when using the zoom cameras when shooting video. After comparing them side by side, it's easy to see why some people are calling the Pixel 9 Pro the iPhone of the Android world. I get it, because in so many ways it does things in a very similar way. If I was recommending which one of these two to buy based on the features and the performance they have right now, I'd base it on a couple of things. If you want more power, better battery life, and better video capture, the iPhone is the one to go for. But for the nighttime photography and the other photo features, plus the suite of useful AI-powered features that come in really handy at times, especially around image editing, the Pixel is also a great choice. Let me know what you think of these two phones. You can shout at me in the comments down below, or you can grab me on social media. I'm at Cam Bunton. If you did like this video, please do leave a thumbs up, subscribe, and tap that notification bell, and I'll see you again in the next one. Bye bye.